Mi nombre es Andrea Parra y soy directora del Programa de Acción por la Igualdad y la Inclusión Social. Hacemos parte de la Facultad de Derecho de la Universidad de los Andes y prestamos servicios legales y nos involucramos en acciones legales en favor de personas que han sido discriminadas por razón de su discapacidad, su vejez, su orientación sexual y su identidad de género. En nombre de la decana Elena Alviar, del doctorado de Derecho y su directora Isabel Cristina Jaramillo, quienes patrocinaron la visita del profesor Dean Spade y realizaron además toda la logística de la semana. En nombre del profesor Esteban Restrepo, del equipo de País y de nuestras organizaciones aliadas Entre Tránsitos y el Grupo de Apoyo Transgenerista, queremos darles la bienvenida a esta jornada a quienes nos acompañan aquí presentemente o a quienes están siguiendo el evento en línea. Quisiera hacer un breve sondeo. ¿Quiénes aquí se identifican como activistas con experiencia de vida trans? ¿Quiénes aquí se identifican como activistas en otros temas? ¿Quiénes representan ONGs u organizaciones que trabajan específicamente en temas relacionados con personas trans? ¿Y en otros temas? ¿Cómo cuáles?
Medios de comunicación alternativos.
¿Medios de comunicación alternativos? ¿Qué otros por allá lo
alternate social media.
Ok, esa es mi siguiente pregunta. ¿Quién aquí representa organizaciones del gobierno? ¿Qué organizaciones? Qué bueno que están acá, bienvenidos.
What types of
¿qué
organizations?
Excelente. ¿Fiscalía?
The District Attorney.
Secretaría de Integración Social.
Social Integration.
Defensoría del Pueblo.
Department.
Departamento Nacional de Planeación.
The National Planning Department.
¿Quiénes aquí representan la academia? Ay, perdón.
El gobierno.
La señora del gobierno. Secretaría de Gobierno e Integración Social. ¿Quiénes aquí
social
pertenecen a la academia, bien sea como docentes o estudiantes?
How many of you guys are part of the faculty,
bien,
either as professors or students?
¿Quiénes están en línea también? ¿Quiénes sienten que llevan un tiempo considerable trabajando en asuntos relacionados con personas trans?
With the trans area.
¿Y quiénes sienten que es un tema nuevo?
And how many of you feel that this is a totally new topic
más
for you? How about the rest?
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
Una de las políticas en la Universidad de los Andes es que las personas externas al campo deben mostrar su identificación para entrar. El hecho de que al organizar espacios de encuentro como este debamos surtir un proceso específico para garantizar que a las personas trans no se les exigirá su cédula y además se autorizará su entrada con base en su nombre identitario no ocurre porque el Departamento de Seguridad de la Universidad sea desconsiderado. Al contrario, siempre nos tienen mucha paciencia y son muy amables. Al igual, el hecho de que al invitar personas trans a estos espacios yo no puedo decirles cuál baño pueden usar, no se debe a que el arquitecto de la universidad sea desconsiderado o una mala persona. Estas aparentemente pequeñas barreras cotidianas se deben a que toda nuestra vida social, legal y política está montada sobre un sistema binario de género, en donde solo caben a quienes designemos como hombres y a quienes designemos como mujeres. Quisiera pedirles por un momento que pensaran en dos ejemplos de cómo ese sistema binario se manifiesta en sus vidas, en sus trabajos, en sus casas, en el espacio público. E invitarles también a que al salir hoy de aquí dejen prendido ese radar. Yo tengo la gran fortuna de trabajar principalmente con personas con discapacidad y con personas trans, dos grupos sociales que activamente resisten parámetros impuestos de normalidad corporal y que resisten su designación como personas que están padeciendo un mal, que están enfermas, que resisten ser patologizadas por un sistema médico y psiquiátrico que reemplaza su voz y define lo que es bueno para ellas. Hoy, Dean Spade, Nikita Vargas y Laura Weinstein van a hablarnos más sobre estas resistencias y también sobre esas barreras cotidianas. Muchas veces las políticas públicas LGBTI son sobre todo G, a veces L, la B, la T y la I quedan escritas en el papel para que parezca que sí hay respuestas para todas las personas. Sin embargo, las personas gays, lesbianas, bisexuales, transgeneristas, queer e intersex no somos una comunidad homogénea y unificada en nuestras prioridades, y hay que problematizar esa visión si nuestro objetivo es la justicia real en la vida diaria de cada persona. Vivimos un momento muy interesante, la aprobación de la ley de identidad de género en Argentina, que permite que cualquier persona se acoja a ella sin que deba demostrar que quiere someterse a un proceso quirúrgico o de hormonización, ha sido una chispa de inspiración en la región. Colombia no es la excepción y estamos siendo testigos de un movimiento de personas trans un poco más visible, con presencia en gobiernos locales, disposición para crear alianzas con otros movimientos y con renovada energía. Ello plantea preguntas y retos frente a qué sigue. ¿Debemos buscar más leyes? ¿Debemos penalizar más conductas? ¿Debemos buscar más castigos para quienes cometen violencia transfóbica? ¿Cómo hacemos para que las leyes sí nos protejan? Dejo entonces que nuestros panelistas sigan la reflexión. En primer lugar, hablará Dean Spade. Después hablarán Nikita Vargas y Laura Weinstein, que nos darán algunos elementos para contextualizar la discusión en Colombia, y luego habrá un espacio para preguntas. Les pido el favor que hagan sus preguntas por escrito para poder dar igual chance a quienes nos están siguiendo en línea y a quienes están en el otro salón que reservamos. Muchas personas inscritas. Hay personas voluntarias con papeles para que escriban sus preguntas si lo desean. Si alguien requiere apoyo para escribir la pregunta, por favor soliciten. Quienes estén en línea, y si pudiera, por favor, el equipo de país puede levantar la mano para que ustedes se ubiquen quienes están cerca de ustedes. Si alguien, quienes estén en línea, por favor escriban sus preguntas por Twitter utilizando arroba país con doble I, Uniandes, país Uniandes, arroba país Uniandes. Bien, quiero darle la palabra a Dean Spade, que es abogado y profesor asociado de la Facultad de Derecho de la Universidad de Seattle en Estados Unidos. Actualmente tiene una beca profesoral en el proyecto Engaging Tradition de la Facultad de Derecho de la Universidad de Columbia en Nueva York. En 2002 fundó el colectivo Proyecto Legal Silvia Rivera, que provee servicios legales gratuitos a personas transgénero, intersex y quienes no se acogen a normas binarias de género, que son de escasos recursos y no blancas. El proyecto Silvia Rivera realiza litigio, reforma de políticas públicas y educación comunitaria en temas que afectan a dichas comunidades y opera con un modelo colectivo de gobernanza que prioriza el liderazgo de personas no blancas, trans, intersex o que no se acogen a normas binarias de género. Durante su tiempo en el proyecto, Silvia Rivera dictó clases sobre temas relacionados con orientación sexual e identidad de género en las universidades de Columbia y Harvard y es el autor del libro que será el tema central de la conferencia hoy, Vida Normal, Violencia Administrativa, Política Crítica Trans y los Límites del Derecho. Una información es que el libro está en proceso de ser traducido, o sea que esperamos que esté disponible en Latinoamérica muy pronto. Muchas gracias, Tim, por estar hoy con nosotros.
Hello, thank you so much for being here today.
Muchas gracias por estar aquí hoy.
I'm so delighted to come to Bogota, and I really am grateful to the School of Law here and to all the people who helped bring this together. Obviously, Andrea, Esteban, Mariana, Lisa, Isabel, and I'm very grateful to Laura and Nikki for being part of this discussion, and I'm grateful to the interpreters. I thought I would share a bit today about the trans movement in the U.S., the work that I'm a part of, and I hope that we can find ways to connect it to the context here in Colombia and have a rich discussion about that. In general, the work that I've been a part of is part of an analysis and a resistance to the ways that legal and administrative systems enforce gender norms on all people. In the U.S., we've had a women's movement, a feminist movement for a long time that has helped us expose a lot of the ways that gender norms work. The women's movement has helped expose how the labor market is divided along lines of gender in ways that cause women to do uncompensated labor, to be forced to do the child care and home work without pay.
The women's movement has produced an analysis of how family law traditionally has structured the family to coerce women into unpaid domestic labor and economic dependence on men, often resulting in situations of violence for women.
So the women's movement has also exposed how the criminal law is set up in the U.S. traditionally to condone violence against women, to say that violence against women is acceptable, especially inside the families. And the women's movement has also helped us see how spaces of criminal law enforcement, like policing and prisons, have been spaces of enforcing gender norms. For example, in women's prisons in the U.S. for a long time, the focus was on rehabilitating women by training them to do
a las mujeres, right, enseñándoles a hacer labores domésticas.
Which was not the same program at the
men's. Este no es el mismo programa
so
en el que
the women's movement has done enormous work to expose many other areas as well, the ways that gender norms operate. And the gay and lesbian movement added additional thinking to that. It exposed how heterosexuality is made compulsory in our society, how it's part of keeping people in their gender roles, how people are punished for being too masculine or too feminine, than whatever is considered the norm, and how people are punished for having sexual desires or behaviors outside of heterosexual norms. The society in the U.S., like many around the world, is built on heteropatriarchy. A set of gender norms govern how we're all supposed to be, how we're supposed to work, which jobs we're supposed to work in, how we're supposed to appear and manage our appearance and clothing and hair and every detail, how we're supposed to have sexuality in our lives, what our role is supposed to be in the family and how we're supposed to be a parent, how our emotions are supposed to be, how we're supposed to care for one another. Every detail of how we walk and talk and eat has gender norms applied to it in our society. You know, everything is his and hers, every item is specified. Trans activists bring an additional layer of analysis to this kind of important thinking about the enforcement of gender norms. Unfortunately, however, trans activists have often been excluded from the women's movement and the gay and lesbian movement in the U.S., have been pushed out. Yet that is ironic because trans activists have often been on the front lines of resisting gender norms and identifying them, and also have been some of the people most severely impacted by the violence of gender norm enforcement. Trans activism has helped us think about this concept of the gender binary more deeply. And when I say that concept, the gender binary, what I'm talking about is the idea that there are just two genders and that they are determined for each person by their genitalia at birth and that they will shape the rest of every aspect of our lives, like I mentioned, how we work, our family role, our emotions, our appearance. This idea of the gender binary tells us that this quality in us is the most important thing about us. It is our fundamental nature. And if we don't see ourselves like that, there's something wrong with us. It says that it is an illness to not see ourselves in the way that we were identified through this ideology and then, you know, named on our bodies at birth. And trans activism rejects that set of ideas. We say that those ideas are mythological, that they do not capture human experience. This binary, however, is enforced by the government very deeply in U.S. society. It's on our identification cards, M or F, for male or female. It's in the fact that government facilities are sex segregated, so prisons and shelters and many, many spaces that we all need to use are men's and women's. It's in the way that medicine is practiced in the U.S. enforces these gender norms. What it is to be a healthy woman and a healthy man are two different sets of standards. And if you have qualities that are considered too masculine or too feminine, it is considered a medical or psychological problem. It's even in our architectural codes, as you mentioned. The zoning codes in many cities and states say you must build the space to have a men's bathroom and a women's bathroom. You may not build bathrooms that everyone can use. It's in every aspect. So trans people are the people in U.S. society who pay a very high price for being incomprehensible in those systems. Sometimes I think about it like gender norms and the gender binary is like a long knife, and everybody is cut by this knife throughout our lives. You know, when you're a child, you're told you can't play with that toy because you're a girl or a boy, or as a parent, you're told you must be like this to be a mother or a father. Everybody is cut by this. Everybody's field of expression is narrowed by this. But trans people live on the point. Right, our existence itself is threatened by this very violent set of gender norms. And one way that I like to think about this concept, which Andrea mentioned is in the title of my book, is this concept of administrative violence. It's a concept that helps us think about how the kind of violence that happens when administrative systems that are supposed to deliver basic human needs, like shelters and healthcare systems, and also systems that distribute state violence, like prisons and militaries, when they use gender norms to do that work. We see administrative violence in the lives of trans people. So I just want to give you some examples of this from my work in the U.S., this kind of violence I'm talking about, one that I've mentioned. In the U.S., many, many people are homeless. Poverty has worsened in recent decades due to a number of neoliberal economic policies, and many people do not have shelter. If you do not have shelter, you're supposed to be able to go to a homeless shelter. But the shelters are all men's and women's. And for trans people, if a trans woman goes to the women's shelter, she'll be denied access. And she can't go to the men's shelter because in the men's shelters, trans women face enormous sexual violence, harassment, and sometimes death. So functionally, trans people are kept out of the shelter system. They have a huge need. Many trans people do not have a family support system, and many cannot get paid work, so a lot of people do not have a place to live. But the way the shelter system is organized prevents our participation in it, prevents us from getting a service. Another example is that trans women in the United States are placed in men's prisons, not women's prisons. So by virtue of what the government sees them to be, the government says, you are not trans, you are a man, you are not a woman, and then places them in men's prisons where they are targets of enormous amounts of violence. In women's prisons, trans men or masculine women are often put in solitary confinement and experience enormous amounts of sexual violence from the guards. Another example of this is our ID cards, which I understand is a similar problem here. We have many, many forms of ID in the U.S., and it relates to what state you live in, and it relates to whether it's your driver's license or your birth certificate or your passport, and they all have different rules. But many of the rules are do not allow trans people to change their gender unless they have had genital surgery. But the vast majority of trans people in the United States never have genital surgery because it's not covered by health insurance, and some people don't want it. And so having this rule means that people do not have a piece of ID that says their current gender, and it's very hard to get jobs because when the employer sees your ID, it doesn't match who you are presenting as. Other examples include not just those kinds of, you know, those are kind of examples about how the computer programs work and how the policies work, but another aspect of this is that the government authorizes people to enforce gender norms on trans people. So one example is in my clients who are in the juvenile punishment system. They're young people who are in jails for kids. They will get extra punishment for being trans. They will be told, by going by that name, you are breaking the rules. By wearing your hair long, you are breaking the rules. By growing your nails, you are breaking the rules. And they spend a longer time in jail. They keep adding time because they are being disobedient. And that is the kind of authority of the people who work in the jail. They're given authority to enforce gender norms on the youth. We see this extensively with the police in the U.S., who target and profile transgender people. Transgender women who walk outside are constantly arrested for sex work, whether or not they are engaged in sex work. And sex work is illegal in the United States, and the people who are caught for it are usually those who work in the street, right? It's safer to work using, you know, computer services and being inside, but often it is the poorest women, often transgender women, who are most in danger. And the police see any trans person as a person they may stop. Right? Just, you look suspicious to me. That's kind of, they're authorized to enforce gender norms in that way. We also see it when our clients go to receive public benefits in a welfare office. Oftentimes they'll be kicked out. You don't look like you're job ready, because if you were ready to work, you would be dressed as a man. Or if you were ready to work, you would be dressed as a woman. So you are not ready to work. We will not give you benefits. So I bring these examples just to think about this daily kind of constant administrative violence, the way that the administrative capacities of the government are used through gender norms so that certain people are cut out or experience too much attention from police or experience being excluded from a service that they need. The result is that in the U.S., trans people are extremely poor. They're very likely to be homeless. Many have to leave school because of this kind of transphobia in the school from the school system. Many do the most dangerous forms of work, especially within sex work. And many have untreated serious health conditions because there's no access to health care for most people. And many, many trans people are in prison. And as a result, overall, trans people die very young. And this concept that I'm talking about of administrative violence, and also this way of talking about state violence, the things the government does that end up causing people to die early, is a particularly important concept in the U.S. because when people think about violence against trans people, they often just think about the person, the stranger who attacks you in the street. That does happen. Trans people experience very high rates of murder in the U.S. But that's not the most common violence. The most common violence, the things that end our lives early, are all the things I've just talked about. And that becomes invisible sometimes when we only focus on the stranger in the street. And also it means we forget to draw our attention to the ways that government policies are producing vulnerability. Many times when trans people are attacked in the street, it's because they were homeless and they didn't have a way to go inside and be safer, or they were doing the most dangerous work and so they were outside, right? So many aspects of that vulnerability to that kind of violence are actually linked to lack of housing, poverty, and experiences of dangerous work. It's also really important to reframe this concept of administrative violence or state violence, because in the U.S., we've experienced a gigantic prison boom, prison expansion boom in the last several decades, fueled by an idea that problems come from dangerous people and that the government is the answer, that law enforcement is the answer, that the government will protect us by locking up the bad people. Certain key terms are thrown around a lot in the U.S. media and by public officials to justify this. Criminal, drug dealer, terrorist. These words are scare words, scare tactics that have fueled the drastic growth of the U.S. prison system in the last 4 or 5 decades. Today, the United States is the number one most imprisoning country in the world. It's the most imprisoning country that has ever existed in the world, which is kind of mind-boggling to think about. More people in cages than has ever happened is happening in the U.S. right now. The United States have 5% of the world's population and 25% of the world's prisoners. And more than 60% of people in U.S. prisons are people of color. The entire criminal system is targeted at people of color, especially black and indigenous people. Most people who are in prison in the United States are in prison because they're poor. They were caught with drugs, possessing drugs, and they live in a poor community where the police, you know, wander around stopping everyone and searching them. Or they engaged in some crime related to being poor, like sex work or minor theft. The system of prisons in the U.S. is privatized. Many of the prisons are run by private companies, and those companies lobby to increase penalties for a variety of offenses, because if they can get more prisoners, they can fill more prisons and make more money. So it's a very disturbing cycle. Being in prison has nothing to do with being dangerous. It has to do with being poor, being a person of color, living in a neighborhood that's more patrolled by the police, and whether or not there's a company trying to make money in your state by building more prisons and filling them. It's an absurd, horrible system. To some degree, more people in the U.S. are beginning to realize this, but it's still just beginning. In order to keep a system like this going, you need an enormous propaganda machine. One form of that is that in the United States, 24 hours a day on television are police crime dramas. Maybe you've seen some of them, Law and Order, CSI. Do you have, they're syndicated all over? So many crime dramas, so you know what I mean. In these shows, the people are always guilty, and the shows depict these dangerous serial killers, as if what the U.S. prison system holds are dangerous serial killers. The people in the U.S. prison system are people who possessed a small amount of marijuana, people who did sex work, not serial killers. But this propaganda helps people feel afraid, like they need police and prisons very badly. And what goes on is that, in general in the U.S., if you are rich or white, you can do all the same things and not go to prison. You won't be pulled over while you're driving your car by the police. You can have drugs. You can be terrible to your children. And the police won't come into your life. But if you're poor, a person of color, and live in those districts, the police are in your life constantly looking for you. Did you walk across the street at the wrong place? All of that, right? Maybe, I don't know if people have followed in New York City, the police department, which is actually one of the biggest. If it was its own country, it'd be bigger than the police departments of many countries. It's like a military, basically. That police department has a policy called stop and frisk, where they stop large numbers of young people of color and just pat them down. And this is a police policy, and there's a big movement against this because it's traumatizing, it's horrible, it's dehumanizing. And then if you do that to people again and again, you will find something sometimes. So it's a funnel for just young people of color into the system. It's interesting form of activism going on right now around that. The thing that we've learned in the trans movement when we look at this, because we are so affected by this system, the criminal system, is that prison does not make anyone safer. That's the big news, right? Prison isn't about making us safer. It's about making money for certain companies and instituting racist regimes of control. But in reality, when people go to prison, they don't get help to not do it again. When they get out, they're even more poor. There's drugs in prison. They get out, they'll still use drugs if they're addicted. There's no prison does nothing to stop any of the harms that it's supposed to address. What it does do is add a great deal of harm. It takes parents away from their children. It disrupts communities. It traumatizes people. There's a high level of sexual violence in prisons against everyone in prison. It's concentrated against LGBT prisoners, but many other prisoners experience it as well. People come out very harmed, oftentimes with deep psychological harms. So we see that prison is not a solution to violence. It is a source of violence. And what we find when we look at the world we live in the U.S. is that the most dangerous people are not in prison. They're the people running the government. They are the police. They are the military. They are the bankers. Those are actually the people causing the most harm to the most people. Right? People in prison are usually actually the victims of that harm. So, one other piece of propaganda that I think is important that justifies the prison system in the U.S. and is very relevant to trans people is the propaganda that says we need to build more prisons to help the prisoners. We need to build more prisons because the prison is too crowded, or because we need to build a new special gender-responsive prison so that women will have a different kind of prison that's more suited to women, or we need to build, some people say, a new trans prison that'll be good for trans prisoners. This is a classic prison expansion logic. If the prison is too crowded, you should let people out, right? You should reduce penalties for things that are absurd, like sex work and possessing drugs. But in the U.S., they will use any excuse to build more prisons, including our lives. Right, and so right now, trans people are facing that dilemma because we can become a reason to build more prisons. And when I was reading about the U.S. Department of Prisons, Bureau of Prisons being involved in building prisons in Colombia, the rationale was about overcrowding. But then what I read said that the prisons in Colombia that the U.S. built are extremely terrible. Bad food, health problems. So I think we see a similar thing, and the U.S. is doing this all over the world. Expanding prisons in the U.S. and all over the world, encouraging or paying for countries to expand prisons that are terrible for people, but saying it's going to be good for prisoners, which is, doesn't make sense. But it's a very common form of propaganda for prisons in the U.S. So the trans movement in the U.S., our focus is to address the major issues that are making trans lives short. How do we address the harm that causes trans people to not have housing, to not have health care? How do we address the state violence, the administrative violence, including and especially criminalization? The number one harm trans people face is the criminal system, the police, and the immigration systems. Those actors are the biggest abusers of trans people. And in order to do that, we have to have a really deep analysis of criminalization so that we avoid false solutions, like, oh, here, have a trans prison. That's not a solution, right? We want to get trans people out of prison, and we want to end this prison expansion, right? So much of my work has been about trying to address these complex legal situations that are impacting trans people's survival, trying to create legal advocacy for people stuck inside these systems, immigration, homelessness, et cetera, and also trying to change the rules of these systems to eliminate some of the major obstacles for trans people's survival. So changing rules about the fact that trans women can't go to women's shelters in many cities, or changing the rules about these different forms of ID so that it's easier for trans people to have an ID that matches our identity, those kinds of things. This is a very important kind of short-term work for people to survive.
Esto ha sido
but
algo que
in the trans movement, we are interested in having both short-term work and long-term vision so that we can make sure that our short-term work is actually moving the direction that we believe in. And the kinds of long-term vision we have are big ideas, like ending prisons and borders. That's a big concept. Ending prisons in the United States, ending borders in the United States, ending the enormous violence that prisons and border enforcement bring to our communities, ending wealth and poverty so that everyone has what they need. And having a context in which everybody can make decisions about our lives, moving away from how it is now, which is that large corporations, wealthy people, and the politicians they own decide what happens to us. Instead, we want people to decide what happens to our land, to our work, to our resources. So moving power down and out. This is a very different idea than the current situation in the U.S. So these are big long-term visions, but they help us if we know we have those visions. It helps us when we're encouraged to take short-term reforms that often are not actually in our interest. A lot of our work is about supporting people who are in these systems now in order to build our movement. We want a powerful movement with trans people at the front. In the United States, trans people, homeless people, people with disabilities are considered disposable. These are people who've been not listened to in movements, pushed aside, hated by many people. And we say, actually, these people know the most about these systems and what needs to change because they're the ones who live at the point of a lot of these violences. So we're trying to build a movement, and that includes helping people survive right now so they can be politically engaged and building organizations that are by and for trans people. Not charity organizations where someone says, oh, here, have a crumb. You know, here, we'll help you a little bit. But instead, organizations that we make that come with our beliefs and our big visions for change. As we do this, we go through a process of assessing the reforms that are possible demands or things that are being offered at times. We want to ask with any reform, is this going to expand or legitimize a system we are trying to dismantle? This is a big deal in the criminal area. As I mentioned, right, if they offer to build a trans prison and then fill it with trans people, that is not in our interest. It expands a system that we're actually trying to get rid of and to reduce. Another big debate in the U.S. is about hate crimes legislation, which is legislation that would increase the penalty if someone attacked you because you're trans. They have it for race, they have it for gender, there's these existing statutes, and some people want trans people to be in there. Many of us say no. Hate crimes legislation does not save our lives, it does not protect us, it just expands the prosecution power of the state. It puts more people in prison, but it does not prevent our deaths. And it invests us in this false idea that prisons are there to protect us, when in reality we know they're not. So we say no, put our resources towards preventing our deaths, put our resources towards changes that will help us have housing, help us have jobs, help us have the things we need. That is what prevents our deaths, not punishing somebody after if they're caught harming us, right? Another question we ask with these reforms is, will this provide material relief, or is it only symbolic? Because oftentimes legal changes allow the state to say, oh yeah, now we protect women, or now we protect people of color, but really nothing has changed. So we ask with each change, is this something that will actually help people survive in our communities, which has led us to move, we put less of our focus on anti-discrimination laws and hate crimes laws, which don't tend to have a lot of support on the ground. They don't tend to make a lot of difference in the U.S. We focus instead on the detailed policies of shelters and prisons and ID. What will really touch the lives of people in our communities? And then another guideline for when we are trying to assess reform opportunities is, will this cause us to leave some people out? Will this only get you health care if you have a job? Will this only get you support of some kind if you have legal immigration status? One of the things that legal reforms often do is they require communities to divide themselves between those who are going to get something and many, the most vulnerable, are not. We don't want to divide. We want to be together and fight for everyone to have it. And this is a very complicated strategic question often. One other piece I want to share about the context in the U.S. is that, and this may have connections here, in the period of the last 30 or 40 years, social movements have professionalized and gone towards an NGO model. So the models of social movements in the U.S. in the 1960s and 70s were more democratic, involved more people, were more broad, and also often had more radical visions. And then in the 1960s and 70s and 80s, the United States government targeted those movements, assassinated many of their leaders, and imprisoned their leaders. And we saw a shift towards wealthy people and foundations supporting social movements to have very narrow agendas, agendas that would comply with contemporary trends in the United States towards building more prisons, expanding the military, and building neoliberal economic reforms. So one of the things we've noticed in the trans movement is that these elite-led NGOs, which are often led by white people, often by lawyers, they are not democratic. The voice of the people impacted is not inside what determines their agenda. We want to build a grassroots movement that can have a strong vision and that won't be tricked into taking reforms that don't really help. So we're moving away from elite control, and we're questioning how oftentimes the foundations that fund, the organizations that fund social movement work, they end up determining the agendas. There's strings attached to the money. They give money where they think something's interesting. So in the U.S., the LGBT foundations are very interested in same-sex marriage, and they don't care about prisoners. And they're not very interested in trans people. So we've seen how that will fuel one piece to be very loud and many other things to be very quiet. And we want to be careful not to have our agenda set by elites. Instead, we want the agenda set by the people most impacted, the people who've often been considered disposable. So we're trying to build horizontal, democratic movements where there's lots of leadership, not just a few people who graduated from Harvard and have been considered an expert. We want the people to lead the movement. And we want to imagine a world where we get to the root causes and change things for those who are most vulnerable, not just change what the law says. The thing about trans people is that as people, we are always told by the government, often by our families, by our religions, that you're impossible. You do not exist. You cannot exist. We defy enormous amounts of pressure, often life-threatening pressure, in order to be ourselves and to say we are possible. It's very intense. It's a very beautiful, complex process. Why do trans people do this? It's amazing that people could resist that much pressure, the whole world structured around the gender binary. And we say, no, I'm going to be me, even though I'm going to lose a lot and be in danger. It's an amazing thing. And in my view, we have to be equally visionary in our politics. It's very difficult in the contemporary U.S. context, where social movements are encouraged to only make messages that support existing U.S. projects of imperialism, of imprisoning people, of racism, of increasing privatization, and of neoliberal economic policy. We say we're not looking to be included in that. We're not looking to have a T put on the outside of that project. We actually want to change the world so that people have what they need. And we believe trans people are part of that global struggle for change. We also recognize that those false reforms don't usually help us. So it's okay to let them go because there's nothing to win there. They're usually just symbolic. I think I mentioned this in another meeting yesterday with trans activists, but the only federal law that has passed so far that has included trans people in the U.S., the big major one, was a hate crimes law that gave tens of millions of dollars to police all over the country. Police are the biggest abusers of trans people. So that's a reform that does not actually help us. But we are told it's what we need. We know that's not what we need. We know what we need. And we are being visionary and fighting for that. But in order to sort of seek this deeper change, we have to be willing to be visionary and to imagine a world where we all have what we need. And where nobody is kept in a cage, which we believe is impossible to justify.
Eso es simplemente imposible de justificar.
And we have to do that by building a trans movement that's deeply connected to poor people's movements and to anti-colonial movements around the world. Opposing harmful U.S. policies inside the U.S. and everywhere where the U.S. spreads its poisonous war on terror and its poisonous war on drugs. So I'm very grateful to be here in Colombia and have a chance to connect with other trans activists and advocates for trans people to try to think about how we can work together in different contexts with some of the same goals and some of the same visions for change. Thank you.
A continuación, Nikita Dupuy Vargas es comunicador social y periodista de la Universidad Jorge Tadeo Lozano, con especialización en políticas exteriores. Artista escénico de la Escuela Nacional de Arte Dramático de Bogotá, ENAD, hizo parte del proyecto Planeta Paz, de Agendas de Paz para Colombia, en el área de Juventud y Comunicaciones. Ha pertenecido a varios colectivos de diversidad sexual y género desde hace 5 años. Desde hace 5 años hace parte de la Fundación Radio Diversia, donde es miembro de la Junta Directiva, y les invito a que la escuchen, es muy bueno. Director y locutor de los programas de análisis político y visibilización de movimientos de contracultura. Hace 4 años es miembro del colectivo Entre Tránsitos, donde ha desarrollado trabajo en las áreas de movilización en la campaña Stop Transpatologización a través del performance itinerante La Chiva Patologizadora. Hace parte del equipo del Universo Pedagógico Propuesta de Educación Popular Alternativa de Personas Trans y Nuevas Masculinidades de la Clare Trans, del Consultorio Trans y el equipo Trans Puppets, que son títeres transiteros. Adicionalmente, ha participado en el Hemisférico de Performance de la Universidad de Nueva York y desarrollado trabajo de performance ritual en temas como crímenes de odio e identidades trans.
Eso es mucha tecnología, ¿no? Hacerme un estudio de tecnologías. Y es en el SENA. Bueno. Muy buenas tardes a todos y todas. Yo lo voy a pasar así, gracias. Mi intervención en este evento se divide en dos partes. En primer lugar, socializar un poco. Andrea me puso la misión de bajar un poco qué es lo que viene sucediendo en la ciudad de Bogotá alrededor del tema trans y los acercamientos con los aspectos legales. Y quería por eso socializar un poco lo que hemos desarrollado como Aquelarre Trans, que es esta coalición de organizaciones trans, en donde estamos dos de ellas, que es el GAT, el Grupo de Apoyo Transgenerista, y el Colectivo Entre Tránsitos, además de País, a partir de los resultados de un evento que se llamó Tacones Legales, Barbas Jurídicas, y en segunda instancia poder reflexionar alrededor de los aportes que el documento de DIN ofrece a las iniciativas de política social, las iniciativas de incidencia política y social de las personas trans. Entonces, hace exactamente un año se desarrolló este evento, precisamente acá en la universidad, se llama Tacones Legales y Barbas Jurídicas, reflexiones estratégicas sobre identidades de género. Fue un evento en donde participamos varios líderes y lideresas trans o de organizaciones aliadas, que por ser aliadas ahora están un poco más disfóricas, pero más felices. Y esto tuvo varios objetivos. Por un lado, era exponer un poco cuáles eran las diferentes herramientas jurídicas y rutas estratégicas que podrían ser útiles para la población trans, cuáles eran los costos y los efectos de las mismas, también analizar y concretar en qué situación se encuentra la población trans en Colombia, y esto traducirlo en términos legales, y finalmente era acercarnos un poco a las diferentes y potenciales estrategias de acción, que podían ser, por ejemplo, litigio estratégico o analizar un poco el tema de la ley de identidad de género en Colombia. La metodología incluyó mesas de trabajo donde se discutieron los siguientes temas, como fue cambio de nombre, libreta militar, salud, vida y seguridad, educación, trabajo, movilidad y derecho al debido proceso. Bocotón. En todas las mesas se analizaban casos documentados, analizábamos los avances que exponía el mismo caso y las alternativas legales que implicaría su solución ideal. Como era de esperarse, todos los casos exponían un fuerte trabajo de incidencia política con diversos estamentos gubernamentales que a la vez implicaban largos procesos. Un ejemplo, ya logramos la casilla LGBT en medicina legal. Ahora, ¿cómo le diferenciamos orientación sexual e identidad de género para que a nuestras chicas trans no las sigan enterrando como hombres gays afeminados? Solo un ejemplo. Esto nos obligaba y nos obliga porque aún estamos en proceso de por sí, gracias a tacones legales, nació el Aquelarre hace un año. Esto nos obligaba a hacer mapeos institucionales, a hacer mapeos con aliados y también hacer un mapeo de detractores. También era acercarnos a la ley. Esto suena muy inocente, pero profundamente interesante para la población trans, porque aunque estamos en un país históricamente legalista, la dinámica de las personas trans es muy distinta. Supongo yo que tiene con esto de que nosotros nos mantenemos constantemente entre lo legal y lo ilegal. Solo nuestros cuerpos lo evidencian. Quienes se han hecho transformaciones corporales legales. 15% de las personas trans. Entonces, creo que la dinámica, esta frontera de lo legal y lo ilegal nos permitía generar unas reflexiones muy interesantes cuando nos acercamos a la ley. También porque nuestras corporalidades, los espacios que habitamos, los ejercicios de poder más fuertes en los que nos encontramos, regularmente no vienen de lo institucional, sino tienen que ver con otro tipo de actores de poder que ayer también analizamos con Dean, y con otras formas de pacto y acuerdo con las que las personas trans están en la cotidianidad, el chulo, la madre, el traqueto, el narco, etcétera, que nos y hacemos otros pactos. Además, considero que este acercamiento a la ley también le ha otorgado otro tipo de roles y lugares sociales a la población trans, que es cada vez más Estado demandante, pero espero nunca Estado dependiente. Acercarnos al asustador artículo del terrorífico código, del angustiante decreto, nos ha llevado por un lado a desnaturalizar muchas cosas que nosotros consideramos y nosotras consideramos inmodificables y sacras porque es la ley. Y en segundo lugar, nos generaba preguntas éticas. Y yo acá voy a arrojar dos ejemplos. Específicamente con el tema de salud mental y libretas militares. Y es porque cuando nos empezamos, este fue otro evento que realizamos sobre salud mental y personas trans, donde participaron precisamente psicólogos y psicólogas clínicas, gente de algunos hospitales y psiquiatras que regularmente entregan certificados de disforia de género, y se sentaron con personas trans a hablar fuera del consultorio, sino de tú a tú, alrededor de cuál es el acompañamiento psicoterapéutico que se está recibiendo. Ese es un ejemplo, y era preguntarnos, bueno, pero en la ley, ¿por qué nos piden el certificado de disforia de género? En mi caso, ¿por qué me tenían que exigir el certificado de disforia de género para hacerme un examen de ginecología? Eso es profundamente violento. Esa es la evidencia de la violencia administrativa de la que habla Dean. Y decíamos, ¿dónde está? No, eso está naturalizado. Eso realmente no es que exista un protocolo en las EPS o en los centros de salud que obligue al hospital a pedirle el certificado de disforia de género para hacer transformaciones corporales y hormonización. Eso lo hemos naturalizado. ¿Y por qué lo hemos naturalizado? ¿Por qué lo piden el cuerpo médico? Y encontrábamos, por ejemplo, en este foro, que ellos decían que funcionaba como salvaguarda para los médicos. Y decían, pues si sirve como salvaguarda, entonces inventemos un consentimiento informado, no patológico. Y ya funciona, listo. Si eso es para lo que sirve el certificado de disforia de género, pues inventémonos otra cosa que no patologice a la gente y que no solo evidencie cuerpos e identidades transexualizadas. Pero dejémoslo ahí en paréntesis. El segundo ejemplo tiene que ver con libretas militares. Decíamos, oiga, bueno, ¿qué hacemos con las libretas militares? Busquemos bien. Venga, ¿en serio que se necesita la libreta militar si yo quiero ser, no sé, cotero de abastos? Oiga, no. Viene que la ley dice que no, que usted solo necesita libreta militar para firmar contratos estatales o ser servidor público. Entonces, ¿por qué hemos naturalizado todos y todas cuando queremos ser, no sé, cajeros de la Olímpica, presentar la libreta militar, la tenemos lista, igual que el RUD, el RID, la fotocopiada, lo tenemos listo, está. ¿Por qué lo hemos naturalizado? Y entonces decíamos, claro, nosotros podríamos exigir libretas militares para hombres trans y no le pedíamos a las mujeres trans. Pero es que ese no es el chiste. Y yo creo que acá aparece la invitación de Dean, y es que hay que agudizar el pensamiento. El certificado de disforia de género o la libreta militar, ¿a quiénes les es funcional? Si son cosas naturalizadas que no aparecen en la ley, ¿a quién les está siendo funcional eso? Y eso nos puso a reflexionar que esto le era funcional a un sistema, claro, y a unas manos invisibles que le funciona. Y por eso entre tránsitos, y agradezco profundamente el trabajo que hacemos, dijimos, no, nosotros no vamos a luchar para que los hombres trans tengan libretas militares, por lo que vamos a luchar es por la objeción de conciencia. Y por eso nos volvemos parceros de la COC, que es la Acción Colectiva de Objetores y Objetoras de Conciencia, y también, y recordaba ahorita las palabras de Dean, y de los grafiteros, que son objetores de conciencia, que los hacen, nos hicieron vender que Diego lo mató el policía, para todos los colombianos nos vendieron el cuento que él estaba robando una buseta, y en octubre mataron a otro compañero grafitero en Miami, otro policía, de 17 años. Hay que ser, hay que agudizar el pensamiento. ¿A quién le está haciendo funcionar estas pequeñas herramientas que nos ofrece lo administrativo? ¿A qué manos invisibles? Y aquí aprovecho a traer a colación a una de las propuestas más potentes que arroja Dean y que tiene que ver con desarrollar una reflexión consciente de las violencias sistemáticas que se ejercen sobre las personas trans y cómo los aparatos administrativos operan bajo esa lógica de discriminación. Para ejemplificar, solo es necesario pensar en lo siguiente, y es que los derechos fundamentales se ejercen en su conjunto de su paquete, ¿no? Es decir, ¿podría yo ser vulnerado en uno de mis derechos mientras no se legitime mi ejercicio en otro? El ejemplo. Acá los sistemas tuvieron el ejemplo. La que la tuvo la posibilidad de participar en la elaboración del informe Sombra, que se presentó a la Comisión de Eliminación de Discriminación contra la Mujer, la CEDAW, que dejó claro que en Colombia el único medio válido para identificarse en cualquier acto civil, político, administrativo, judicial, es la cédula de ciudadanía. Para que las personas trans podamos ejercer el poder y poder cambiar nuestro género con el que nos identificamos, es de obligatoriedad la cirugía genital externa. Lo que nos arroja tres preguntas. Todas las personas trans deseamos una cirugía, esta transformación corporal. Aún más, para ser persona trans hay que tener transformaciones corporales. ¿Qué pasa con esas otras identidades no transexualizadas que no deseamos hacer esta reasignación? Entonces nosotros no cumplimos con ese género. Y si deseo hacerlo, ¿con qué oportunidades materiales y económicas cuento? Aunque la sentencia de Julian Schneider Clavijo, que aparece en las obras de ustedes, pareció ser una luz en el camino, la exigencia de su patologización para el tratamiento hormonal y quirúrgico nos hizo saltar de la corte al consultorio psiquiátrico. Pero todo eso hace parte de un mismo sistema binario, biologicista, heteronormativo y patologizado, que camina vigilante desde la salud hasta la personalidad jurídica, sin mencionar trabajo, educación y otras cosas. Luego de la cirugía, Julian va a obtener tanto su cédula como su libreta militar para poder acceder a un trabajo digno. Va a tener que pagar por ello. Y si no paga, y si no ejerce, y si queda en calle, ¿en qué hogar de paso lo metemos? Para el aquelarre trans, ese panorama lo ha llevado a complejizar esta incidencia política y legal, eligiendo solamente la salud y el servicio militar como primeros ámbitos, porque hay un pocotón. Lo que a su vez nos ha encontrado con otros movimientos sociales fuera del espectro LGBT. Sí. Habemos, eso es como un mito, pero habemos. ¿Cuáles son esos otros movimientos? Educación popular. Hacemos parte de los movimientos de educación popular porque efectivamente creemos que la educación expulsa a cualquiera que no lleve una vida normal, como el título de Dean, a los objetores y objetoras de conciencia, a los movimientos de nuevas masculinidades, a los movimientos también de personas con discapacidad y a los movimientos que tienen que ver con el tema de salud mental. Otros y otras actores sociales. En el evento de Tacones Legales y Barba Jurídica, y también días anteriores, pudimos contar con la participación de Emiliano Litardo, abogado argentino, activista jurídico y pieza clave en la elaboración del documento de la Ley de Identidad de Género en Argentina. Con él reconocimos cuatro vértices fundamentales de dicha ley: despatologización, desjudicialización, desestigmatización, tanto en la diversidad de los cuerpos como de las identidades trans, y la descriminalización. A mí esto último me permite entender, a lograr hacer una conexión transcontinental de Argentina, Colombia a Estados Unidos, donde desde comentarios que hace Dean en su documento hasta referencias que, por ejemplo, hace Santa María Fundación de Cali, nos arroja el perfil predelictivo que tienen las identidades trans y que no solo influye en el acceso a la justicia y la justiciabilidad de las mismas, sino que legitima lo que Santa María Fundación, por ejemplo, en Cali, habla como el DEMIB, D-E-M-I-B. Discriminación, exclusión, marginación, invisibilización y violencia por parte de los aparatos estatales contra las personas trans. Tener a Emiliano narrándonos el proceso argentino de la Ley de Identidad de Género y meses antes a Loana Berkins, en el aquelarre, nos ha generado una serie de preguntas que parecen coincidir también con una de las inquietudes que arroja Dino. Las leyes que ni siquiera mencionan identidad de género, sino que hablan de orientación sexual, que ni siquiera mencionan identidad de género, pueden ser la respuesta. Para las organizaciones trans parece que eso ni siquiera está en discusión. Lo que necesitamos aquí es una ley de identidad de género en Colombia, hemos dicho todos y todos. Y con las personas trans parece que además pasamos de los limbos de la ilegalidad tan chévere a la confianza absoluta de la herramienta. Y aunque yo confieso venir de esa corriente romántica y casi religiosa de la ley de identidad de género, la pregunta de cómo hacerlo me detiene un poco. ¿Realmente las organizaciones trans estamos pensando y planificando las diversas estrategias para conseguirlo? ¿Y eso cómo opera en Colombia? Porque si algo hemos aprendido de las políticas públicas es que no son la panacea y solo son funcionales cuando se tiene muchísima claridad en cómo se operan y cuáles son los diferentes papeles que juegan cada uno de los actores estatales y civiles. No solo en este caso la población trans, sino de esos otros actores con los que también hablamos. Asimismo, hay que pensar en cuáles son las alianzas dentro de la población para considerar que la ley de identidad de género es una agenda sectorial que moviliza masivamente. Masa que expone diversos tránsitos que no esperaría sucumbir ante una ley que, como patologización, privilegia ciertos modelos de tránsito bajo perspectivas binarias. Y saben, de parte de mi romanticismo, yo creo que sí es posible lograrlo. Porque yo no he visto en otro sector, a excepción de aquellos que trabajan con el VIH, y que es por cuestiones financieras, porque les gusta saltar y bailar la ronda que la Cooperación Internacional les puso. Pero yo sí he visto diversas conversaciones con las organizaciones y activistas trans, alianzas, cuestionamientos, encuentros, desencuentros, pero interesantes reconocimientos de cada uno de sus agenciamientos. Eso sí, no me queda tan claro cuáles son esos encuentros con los actores lésbico, gays o bisexuales en Colombia. Supongo que no los he visto, porque como la mayoría de personas trans coincido con Dean, yo he decidido tomar distancia de las agendas LGBT, pensando en lo perverso que ha sido mantener la sigla que invisibiliza en la diversidad sexual cuestionamientos y necesidades profundas de nuestra población diversa en su género. Podemos ser solidarios, podemos apoyar, pero no son nuestra bandera. La agenda social y política trans incluye conseguir los recursos sociales y materiales para sobrevivir ya y ahora. Una reflexión de las organizaciones y de las personas que trabajamos, por ejemplo, en localidades como Los Mártires, era esa. Es que la necesidad es inmediata, más aún cuando uno desarrolla procesos de intervención con personas en habitabilidad de calle y en ejercicio de prostitución. Y finalmente, porque ya me pasaron el papelito. Yo lo que quiero aquí es dejar claro que Dean lanza una pregunta muy fuerte al nervio ético. Y creo que ese es el gran aporte que nos puede dar. Y que no es una cuestión no solamente activista, sino es una pregunta que le lanza a los abogados, que esperemos que el día de mañana no solo sean abogados, sino defensores de derechos humanos. A la academia y a los servidores y servidoras públicos. Y es poder voltear una pregunta, ¿cierto? Y es esta pregunta que ha sido de la verborrea activista privante de la diversidad sexual y de género, y es, ah, lo personal es político. Pero yo siempre me he hecho la pregunta, ¿qué de eso político es tan personal? ¿Sí? ¿Cómo opera en lo personal? ¿Cuál es el sentido ético? Que creo que además es un reto para las personas que trabajamos con personas trans, porque es una respuesta, preguntarse por el sentido, tiene que dar una respuesta en el aquí, ya, ahora, en el aquí, calle, en el ya, meta, plan, acción, y en el ahora, atención, intervención con otros y otras ciudadanos, mientras seguimos consumiendo todos los sistemas de violencia, por ejemplo, simbólicos que nos sigue arrojando Colombia en medio de esa reflexión. No es gratuito que nuestro producto interno gourmet tipo exportación sea el capo, los municipios de la mafia, o si es algo. Finalmente, como esto se trataba, aún así, de una digamos de una reflexión transcultural, quería aprovechar de que Dean viene del proyecto Silvia Wright Rivera. Entonces, mientras él hablaba de Silvia Wright Rivera, yo me acordaba de mi Silvia Wright, pero mi Silvia Rivera es otra.
Here's my Silvia Rivera.
Silvia Wright Kusakousi-Kanki es una activista boliviana, antropóloga, que viene desarrollando un proceso muy fuerte sobre las colonizaciones mestizas contra población indígena en Bolivia. Y ella tiene una frase muy maravillosa que dice, la micropolítica es un deber moral para evitar que cualquier devenir macropolítico le joda a uno la vida.
Gracias, Nikki. Siempre es un placer
escucharte. It's always a pleasure to have you here.
Quisiera darle la palabra ahora a otra gran aliada, Laura Weinstein, historiadora de la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén, trabajadora social en formación de la Fundación Universitaria Monserrate, defensora de derechos humanos, exvocera de la Mesa LGBT de Bogotá, fundadora de la Fundación Trans Revolucionando Género, coordinadora del Grupo de Apoyo Transgénero GAT, funcionaria del Centro Comunitario Digital LGBT y actual Centro de Cuidadanía LGBTI, ponente en diferentes espacios académicos en temática de género, formadora en derechos humanos con población trans en el marco de presupuestos participativos, entre otros.